From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Author Interviews. Thanks for joining us. I'm Dr. Gregory Curfman, and I'm the executive editor of JAMA. I'm speaking today with Dr. Stephen Nissen, who is a leading cardiovascular researcher at the Cleveland Clinic. Dr. Nissen was the principal investigator of a recent clinical trial now published at jamanetwork.org, which is titled Zerlasiran, a small interfering RNA targeting lipoprotein little a. Dr. Nissen, welcome to the podcast.
Well, thank you very much, Greg. It's a pleasure to speak with you.
Now, your research dealt with lipoprotein little a, so let's begin by having you explain to our listeners what lipoprotein little a is and why they need to know about it.
You know, it is interesting. A few years ago, the New York Times wrote an article titled, "A Heart Risk Factor Even Doctors Know Little About," and they were referring to lipoprotein A. It's a lipid particle we've known about for a long time, but we weren't able to treat until very recently. It consists of a core particle that looks a little bit like LDL. It's got apolipoprotein B associated with it, and it's connected by a disulfide bond to apolipoprotein A. This lipid particle is at abnormal levels in about 20% of the world population. To give you an idea of that prevalence, that's about 64 million people in the U.S., and it's 1.4 billion people globally. It's important because it is strongly associated with increased risk of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease and aortic stenosis.
Now, Zerlasiran was specifically designed to lower lipoprotein A levels. And I wonder if you could explain how it works mechanistically in lowering those levels.
So it's important to understand that lipoprotein A is not affected by any other of the conventional drugs we use for reducing risk in ASCVD. It's not lowered by statins or, you know, fibrates or any of the other typically used therapies. It's largely determined genetically. And in fact, if you obtain levels in a three-month-old, those levels are the same for the entire life of that individual. So the only way that we can really tackle this problem is to silence the gene. And Zerlasiran silences the gene using a technology called small interfering RNA. It's a small piece, just a couple of dozen nucleotides of double-stranded RNA, and it's attached to a sugar known as GalNAc, N-acetylgalactosamine. And that sugar has a receptor in the liver, in hepatocytes. And so the hepatocyte then picks up this drug after it's injected subcutaneously, gets into the circulation, rapidly taken up by the hepatocytes. And it then forms what's known as a risk complex within the hepatocytes, where the messenger RNA for lipoprotein A is degraded. And the way it works is that the message is for the formation of the component of apolipoprotein A. And so if you block production of apolipoprotein A, you never assemble the particles, you never make lipoprotein A, and levels drop considerably.
All right, thank you very much for that. Now, I wonder if you could describe your clinical trial and your results and why you decided to undertake the trial now.
Okay, well, first of all, this is a very exciting area of research, and there are multiple drugs in development working some by similar mechanisms and some by other mechanisms. But in order to determine the optimal doses for a large phase 3 cardiovascular outcome trials, because that's what's going to be required by regulators around the world to approve any of these drugs. We have to know the right dose. And phase two trials, like this phase two trial, are typically designed to find the right dose. So we took a group of patients, about 180 of them, and randomized them into several groups, two different placebo groups, and then a group that received 300 milligrams of this drug subcutaneously every 16 weeks, 300 milligrams every 24 weeks, or 450 milligrams every 24 weeks. Now, one of the challenges here is because of the long duration of action of these small interfering RNAs, getting the dose right takes some time. And so this trial went out to 60 weeks. Importantly, the endpoint, the primary endpoint for the study, is different from what has been reported for previous studies of other drugs. The primary endpoint was the time average reduction in lipoprotein A from baseline to 36 weeks. What we found is that there was between an 80 and an 85% reduction for all three dose groups during that 36-week period of time. And that actually persisted with almost 80% reduction all the way out to 60 weeks. So very durable effect. The starting levels of lipoprotein A were at the level that we would want to have patients at for a phase three trial, somewhere above about 200 nanomoles per liter. There are two important observations I would like to highlight. One is that with multiple doses, with each successive dose, there was a lower and lower lipoprotein A level reached. What that means is that the effects are cumulative. We absolutely needed to know that because an outcome trial is going to go on for years. And what we really want to know is what will the steady state reduction in lipoprotein A look like in a long-term multi-year trial? The second major issue was consistency. And so we show waterfall plots, and those waterfall plots show that the most consistent effect was with the dosing every 16 weeks. The 300 milligrams every 16 weeks. When you go to longer dosing intervals, there are some people who get less reduction, and so there's less consistency in the reduction. So it's a very important insight for designing phase three. And then the other important point I would like to emphasize is safety. Because this class of drugs has a very low residence time in the circulation. It's only in the circulation for 36 to 48 hours. That inherently makes these drugs safer than many other therapies we've studied. And that's exactly what we saw here. There were no serious adverse events related to study drug. There was a handful of annoyance kind of adverse effects that occurred both in placebo and in the treated group, like headache and nasopharyngitis. So very, very safe drug, at least in a study of 180 patients. Now, one could argue that we really need to see the safety in thousands of patients, but we're pretty confident that because of the mechanism here, it's a very targeted therapy. It's targeted at a very specific gene product, messenger RNA for apolipoprotein A, and it knocks out that messenger RNA, and that's the only thing that it appears to do, which makes it inherently safe. One more additional point. In addition to lowering lipoprotein A, zerlasiran also lowered LDL about 25 to 30% and apolipoprotein B in the range of 10 to 15%. that may or may not contribute to potential benefits on clinical outcomes, but is certainly something we like to see.
There's another very key point that I'd like you to address, and you bring this up in your paper. It's not yet known if lowering lipoprotein A levels with a drug intervention, such as Zerlasiran, results in any clinical benefit to patients. So I want to ask you, what are the next steps in your research?
Well, we have to do phase 3 trials. The regulators are going to require them, but the medical and scientific community are going to require them. We think the probability of success in an outcome trial is high. That's one of the reasons why multiple companies are developing this type of drug for lipoprotein A. The genetic Mendelian randomization studies and epidemiological studies consistently show a very strong relationship between lipoprotein A levels and clinical outcomes. It is now our job to show that lowering those levels can in fact produce a clinical benefit. We're very optimistic here, and we're very hopeful. This disorder causes an enormous amount of morbidity and mortality globally, and we need therapies. We have nothing right now. There's nothing that we can do other than apheresis, which is very cumbersome. And so we hope that these drugs will work. We are reasonably confident they will work, but we have to prove it.
Absolutely. And you're spending a lot of time and effort on this interesting problem. And do you have any final thoughts for our listeners?
One really important point. We did a study of 48,000 people globally with ASCVD, and we asked a very simple question. What percent of them had had a lipoprotein A level checked by their physicians? And it was 13.9%. I just heard of a study done by Gisette Reyes-Sofer at Columbia, where in their population, 2.8% of people with ASCVD had had their levels checked. So what we need to now do as we prepare for the likelihood that these drugs will eventually become available is we have to find out who has this disorder. And to find that out, there's a couple of things that absolutely we have to do. We have to find people in families who have a family history of disease and check their levels. And we have to check the levels of first-degree relatives of patients that have the disorder. A very important study published recently in JAMA Cardiology showed that first-degree relatives have a 47% chance of having a similarly elevated lipoprotein A to their other first-degree relatives. So we've got to do cascade testing. We've got to do it now, because if these drugs turn out to work in phase 3 trials, we have to know who to treat.
Well, Dr. Nissen, thank you very much for your thoughtful comments about this very interesting and important area of investigation.
And thank you for having me.
I'm Dr. Gregory Curfman, and I've been speaking with Dr. Stephen Nissen about lipoprotein A. You can find a link to his JAMA article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musizi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.